In World War II, the Germans came up with what seemed to be an unbreakable code called Enigma. This is one of the machines they used to encode and decode their messages. Among other things, the Germans used the code to position their so-called submarine wolf packs on the Atlantic shipping lanes. These submarines were sinking British shipping at a prodigious rate in what Winston Churchill called the Battle of the Atlantic. Churchill worried that Britain would be starved into defeat unless the submarine campaign was stopped. Breaking the Enigma code was one way to stop it. If the British could read Enigma messages, their navy could locate and destroy the subs. Breaking the code is based on incidents in the life of a mathematical wizard named Alan Turing. Turing was a key figure in solving the Enigma puzzle. But he was important for other reasons, too. Before the war, when he was still in his 20s, he pioneered the development of the digital computer and even pushed the theory that computers could be made capable of thinking. Men like Turing are usually hard to take for government people who need their brains but fear they're too different from you and me to be entirely trustworthy. Turing may be a hero for breaking one code, but in tonight's story, breaking another makes others see him as a threat to society. Incidentally, Derek Jacobi's stammer in tonight's performance is not an effort to repeat something he did marvelously in Icleus. The real Alan Turing also stammered. Now, complete in one episode, Breaking the Code.
Sorry to keep you waiting, sir. Right, let's get the basic facts sorted out. We're talking about a burglary that occurred on January the 23rd, and you are Mr. Spurling.
No, Turing. T-U-R-I-N-G.
Mick Ross, Detective Sergeant. How do you do, sir? Would you like to come with me, sir?
Is this your list, sir?
Yes.
A shirt, 5 fish knives, a pair of tweed trousers, 3 pairs of shoes, a compass, an electric shaver, half-empty bottle of sherry. It's not much of a haul.
Well, I live simply. Possessions, per se, mean very little to me.
Now then.
You said
to the constable, you told him that you had some idea who might have committed the crime.
Well, yes, I think his name's George.
George what?
I don't know.
Who is this man? Can you describe him?
Well, no, I've never seen him.
But you know his name?
Yes, somebody told me.
Told you what, sir?
That this man George might be a burglar.
Who told you?
Well, a young man came to the door and was selling something. Bratley's or something, and he told me to be careful because he'd heard them talking about a burglary. They were in a pub, you see, and he overheard them planning a burglary.
This man, George, he heard him making some sort of a plan to burgle your house?
No, not my house specifically. No, a house in my neighbourhood. Or so I gather. That's what I was told. Young man, the brush salesman, said that he knew the man he was talking. George. He recognised him, you see.
Why didn't you inform the police at the time?
Well, it never occurred to me to do so. It was a casual remark. He said, be careful, keep your eyes open. I really didn't pay much attention.
What sort of brushes was he selling?
I had no idea. It might not even have been brushes. I forget.
It would be helpful if you could remember.
Yes, I'll try.
He should never have lied. That was the real mistake. I have some very definite ideas of right and wrong, and it's always wrong to lie.
Well, perhaps he was afraid.
Well, of course he was afraid. He cheated during the Latin exam. He knew he'd be found out. He knew he'd be punished, but lying made everything 100 times worse.
Alan, is that you?
Lord, it's my mother.
Oh, there you are. Do forgive me. I thought I heard the doorbell, but I wasn't quite sure. I was in the garden, you see. Do forgive me. Well, aren't you going to introduce your friend?
Sorry, Christopher Morecambe.
How do you do, Christopher?
How do you do, Mrs. Choi?
I'm delighted to meet you at long last. Alan has talked so much about you, and I kept saying to him, do bring Christopher down for the weekend, never expecting for a moment that he would. Whatever we say, he always tries to keep his school friends to himself. I think perhaps he's ashamed of us. Do come through. Come along this way. Do sit down, won't you? Sit over here by me.
Thank you.
How long have you been at Sherburn?
A year longer than touring, Alan.
Are you enjoying it?
Very much.
Choosing the right school is so tremendously important, don't you think? I'm very impressed with Sherburn.
It's not that wonderful.
Well, of course it is. Why, what's wrong with it?
Well, for one thing, they don't treat mathematics as a serious subject.
I can't believe that.
Well, it's true. I mean, you know what our form master said the other day? He said, this room stinks of mathematics. And then he said, looking straight at me, he said, go out and get a disinfectant spray.
Well, he was joking.
No, he hates anything to do with science or mathematics. You know, he once said, and he meant it, he said that the Germans lost the Great War because they thought science was more important than religion.
Well, the teaching of mathematics is not the only way to judge the qualities of a school.
Well, it is as far as I'm concerned.
I gather you share this enthusiasm for sums and science.
Oh, yes, very much so. Morecambe's brother's a scientist, Mother. I mean, they've got their own laboratory at home.
Really?
Is that Chris has got his own telescope.
Really? How splendid.
Oh, it's tremendous, Mrs. Turing. Absolutely splendid. The other night, did I tell you, the other night I actually saw one of Jupiter's satellites coming out from eclipse. It was amazing. Gosh. The sky was wonderfully clear. Absolutely cloudless. I felt I was wandering through the universe. Jupiter, Sirius, Betelgeuse, the Andromeda Nebula. It was quite overwhelming. The hugeness of creation. Gosh, how terrific.
Yes, it all sounds very fascinating, I must say. Fascinating, but far beyond my grasp. It's the same with that theory Alan was telling me about. What is it you know, the man with the Jewish name?
Mr. Einstein.
Einstein, yes. Didn't understand a word of it, not one single word. Let's have some tea, shall we? Do wash your hands, Alan, they're covered in ink. Did Alan tell you about my grandfather's cousin? He was a scientist. He invented the electron.
He didn't invent it, but Mother, electrons exist. You can't invent them.
Well, he found them or discovered them or something. He's a member of the Royal Society, very distinguished. Don't wash your hands, Alan. Come along.
Look, Chris.
I'm sorry, Morgan, one can't choose one's own mother.
She's all right.
Do you know what I wish?
What?
You know, I wish this was my house. I mean, my own house. And we could live here, you and I. We could have our own rooms, our own laboratories. We could just work together, share everything. And what a wonderful life that would be.
Yes. Yes, it would.
Come along, Christopher!
I better go. Oh, Chris. Thank you for coming to see me today. Don't forget to wash your hands.
Is anyone sitting here?
No.
Bloody cold, eh?
Real Christmas weather.
Bloody Christmas. How was the film?
Yeah. It's quite good. Snow White. I've seen it before. It's worth a look.
Yeah, I think I saw it. Mum took me. Isn't there a wicked witch in it?
Yes, she gives Snow White a poisoned apple. But it all ends happily. She falls asleep and wakes up in the arms of a handsome prince. It's really quite touching.
I like a thriller myself. Good thriller.
You go to the pictures? Oh.
Nah, can't afford it. Well, not anymore. I'm out of a job.
It's bad luck.
Yeah. Telling me. Now I'm stuck at home. Not much fun in that. What about you?
I've got my own place.
No, I meant your job.
I'm at the university.
You're a bit old for that, aren't you?
Well, I'm on staff.
Oh, a teacher?
Well, no, not exactly. I do research work.
Like what?
Scientific, mathematics. Actually, we're trying to build a special sort of machine. What people call the electronic brain.
Bloody hell. That sounds a bit...
Bit what?
It sounds like that film. Oh, what's it called? Michael Rennie. I saw him as down in London. Michael Rennie and some sort of robot.
Oh.
The Day the Earth Stood Still.
The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Did you see it?
No.
Oh, bloody good. So what does it do, this thing you're making?
Well, you give it problems, mathematical problems, and it solves them very quickly.
How quickly?
Very, very quickly. Far more quickly than a man could.
What, yeah, like an adding machine?
No, it's more than that. No, what we're trying to do is to build a machine that can learn things and eventually think for itself.
Bloody hell.
It's not exactly a robot, and, well, it's not really a brain, not like the human brain, anyway. It's what we call a digital computer.
And you thought this up, did you?
Yeah, it's all done.
Must be interesting, a job like that.
Oh, yes, it is.
Good money, too, I bet.
It's not bad. Would you like something to eat? There's a cafe just down the road.
No, I can't. Not really, yeah.
All right. It's okay.
Bye. How about some other time?
Yes, all right. When?
Don't mind.
This weekend?
If you like.
What about Friday evening?
Okay.
Yeah. You come to my house.
Okay.
This is the address. You come to my house. Do you know where that is?
Yeah, I can find it.
Well, come about 7 o'clock and I'll cook you a meal. Mm.
Good cook, eh?
Well, not bad. What's your name?
Ron.
Alan.
Come out a bloody mess.
Hmm? What?
This place. Never seen such a muddle. And what's all that stuff in the bathroom?
Oh, don't touch that. That's potassium cyanide. It's poison. I'm trying to make some weed killer.
What for?
To kill weeds.
Well, why don't you buy some? You could afford it.
Well, I like making things. It's fun.
What made you start all this?
Oh.
Yeah, being interested in science and things.
Well, I've always been interested.
What, even as a kid?
Mm, even then. Yes, even then. When I was a child, numbers were my friends.
You what?
My friends. Oh, God, no, you know how it is. You know how children have their own secret, make-believe friends. Friends who can always be trusted. Dolls, teddy bears, some piece of old blanket that they've kept in treasure since they were babies. Well, my friends were numbers. They were so wonderfully reliable. They never broke their own rules. And then, when I was about 9 or 10, someone gave me a book for Christmas. It was called Natural Wonders Every Child Should Know. I thought it was the most exciting book I'd ever read. I suppose, looking back, it was a kind of gentle introduction to the facts of life. Not about chickens and eggs, I remember. But what the author of that book managed to convey was this idea that life, all life, is really a huge, all-embracing enterprise of science. No nonsense about God and divine creation. All science. Chemicals, plants, animals, humans. The body is a machine, he said. How exciting it was to read that. What an audacious, challenging, rather naughty idea that was. See, he made life seem like a thrilling experiment. And I longed to take part in that experiment.
Have you always been queer?
Yes.
Never fancied girls?
No.
I like a bit of both myself. I mean, I'd rather have a girl given the chance, but I mean, they're not so easy to get. Not when you're broke. Some real old queen picked me up when I was in London. Silk sheets, mirror over the bed. Bit different to this place. And you don't half snore.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just like me dad. You can hear him snoring all over the bloody house.
What were you doing in London?
How do you mean?
Well, I mean, were you working? Were you on holiday? What?
Well, sort of holiday, I suppose. I tried to get a job down there, but nothing worked out. I got nicked pinching food from Woolworths, and they sent me back here on probation. Oh. What's that place down the road?
What place?
Well, that big shed. You can see better from the bedroom window. Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's an old aircraft hangar.
Didn't know the RAF was up here.
Well, they were during the war.
Were you here then?
Me? No.
Where were you?
Round and about.
Doing what?
I was working for the government.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Now, listen, I'll tell you something strange about that hangar.
What's that?
It grows bigger at night.
Bigger?
You look.
Oh, bollocks.
Yeah, it's true. It seems to, anyway. I mean, during the day, it's an ordinary large shed, but when the sun goes down, it seems to grow bigger and bigger. I'm thinking of writing a story about it.
Good, Harry.
Do you think so?
Well, why not?
Yeah, it's rather like that film that you enjoyed so much.
Oh, the one about the robots?
Yeah, it's quite creepy. It's quite spooky. You see, I imagine that I go inside the hangar and it's deserted. It's derelict. It's very dark. You can't see a thing. And as I go inside, the door bang shut behind me.
No way out.
No way out. And then I realise it's not a hangar at all. I'm trapped inside an enormous mechanical brain. And this brain, the hangar, it starts to play chess with me. And I've got to win, otherwise I'll never get out. All day and all night we play, and all the next day, all the next night, but the brain's too clever for me. I can't keep up with all the moves, and I'm terrified that I'm going to be trapped in here for the rest of my life. You see, the trouble is I can't think of a good ending.
Flash Gordon comes in and rescues you.
I thought maybe I could find a piece of chalk and write a few sums on the wall. Easy sums, simple arithmetic, that sort of thing. And I'd do the sums deliberately badly. I'd make silly mistakes. And I'd do them so slowly and so badly that the brain would grow more and more despairing.
What?
The brain commits suicide. What do you think of that?
Flash Gordon's better.
Mm. Yeah, maybe.
Have you got any tea?
Yes, I think so.
Well, no tea, just coffee. The bread's all mouldy.
No, we can get some breakfast later.
Look, I'm starving. Aren't there any shops around here?
Yes, there's one at the end of the road.
Well, I'll nip down, shall I? Have you got any money?
Well, put some clothes on.
Come on. Right.
I'll give you some money.
Right, I'll get some tea and bread. And how about some bacon?
Have you been taking money out of my wallet?
What?
Okay, you heard.
No, I haven't touched your bloody wallet.
I had £15 in it yesterday. £7 left.
Yeah, well, it's got nothing to do with me.
Well, where's it gone then?
How should I know?
Come on, give it back.
I haven't got it.
I don't believe you.
All right, search me.
Don't be ridiculous, mate. You've hidden it somewhere.
What are you talking about? Why should I take money from you?
You said you were hard up.
I didn't.
You said you were out of work.
So what?
No, please, Rob, give it back. Come on, give it back and we'll say no more about it.
I am not a bloody thief.
But you just said you were. You said you were on probation.
Well, if you think I paid someone, call the police. Go on, there's the phone.
Put it down.
Rob,
put it down. Put it down. Look, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Perhaps I made a mistake. Where are you going?
I'm not bloody staying here.
No, please don't go.
Please don't go.
No, look, I must have made a mistake. I mean, I thought there was £15. Perhaps it wasn't. Come on, let's forget about it. Go on, go and get us some breakfast.
Get it yourself.
No, look, I've said I'm sorry.
So what?
Well, let's be friends. Do you want some money? Do you? How much do you need?
I'm not a bloody renter.
No, I know. But if you want money, you're only going to ask me.
All right, call it a loan, then.
Well, how much?
Three.
Go on, go and get us some breakfast.
One shirt, five fish knives, one pair of tweed trousers, three pairs of shoes, one compass, an electric shaver, and a half-empty bottle of sherry. Is that all?
So he says.
What do you make of it?
I'm not sure, sir. Doesn't add up somehow. He's not telling us everything.
You think he's lying?
I think he might be.
Let me know what happens. Your superintendent knows where to find me.
Yes, sir.
Handle this carefully, Ross. Carefully and discreetly. There are certain anxieties. The Foreign Office wants to avoid any possible embarrassment.
I didn't know he was mixed up with the Foreign Office.
Oh, he got to be their chap during the war. Quite a big fish, our Mr. Turing. Winston thought the world of him.
So you found us all right?
Oh, yes, thank you. No problem.
It's a silly question, really. I mean, here you are. Of course you found us. Punctual to the minute. Bravo. That's quite an achievement these days. If only Churchill could take a leaf out of Mussolini's book and make the trains run on time. Which one did you catch?
I got here this morning, actually.
This morning?
Well, I didn't want to be late.
You've been here all day?
Yes.
Oh, dear. Poor you. Sit down. You must be wondering, when and this is all about?
Well, I know your reputation as a code breaker, Mr. Knox, so I rather assume it was something to do with the deciphering work you're doing here at Bletchley.
You heard about that?
Yeah, well, not much, just talk.
What sort of talk?
Amongst my colleagues at Cambridge.
Well, it's supposed to be tremendously secret, this place. I mean, really, tremendously secret. Hence all the soldiers of barbed wire and passwords and so on.
Well, yes, I realise that.
How did you get in, by the way? Did they tell you the password?
I showed them your letter.
Did you? Good. I always make the most frightful hash of this password nonsense. Must be something to do with my age.
In what respect?
Failing memory. We all live far too long. That's the trouble. Faculties fade, body disintegrates, mind crumbles. My solicitor says that dentists are to blame. He opines that nature intended us to die as soon as our teeth drop out. But thanks to the advances in dentistry, we struggle on into an infirm and wretched old age. Yes?
So I didn't speak.
What was I saying?
Passwords.
This place is supposed to be called Station X, but everybody knows it's the Government Code and Cipher School, the GCCS, waggishly referred to as the Golf Club and Chess Society. You'll have to bear with me, Turing. I'm not an administrator, neither am I a mathematician, but since it seems highly likely that we should be working together, the powers that be think we should have some sort of exploratory conversation. Is that all right with you?
Yes, of course.
This is your file. I shall consult it from time to time. There's no need to be alarmed.
No, I'm not.
I see that you have an interest in codes and ciphers. How did that begin?
Well, I've always been interested, I think, ever since I was a boy. I remember getting a prize at school, a book called Mathematical Recreations and Essays, and there was one chapter on cryptography, and I found it fascinating. Then, much more recently, I realized that my ideas in mathematics and logic could be applied to ciphers.
I gather you're... We're a supporter of the anti-war movement at Cambridge.
In 1933, yes.
Would you describe yourself as a pacifist?
No.
You've changed your mind?
No. I've always thought some wars could be justified.
Justified? How?
As a lesser evil in the last resort. Hitler has brought us to that last resort.
So you would describe this war as a necessary evil?
Yeah, first and foremost, I would describe this war as the most unfortunate interruption to my work. But I also think that... I do think that this war is a necessary evil.
And what about loyalty to your country? Sense of duty? Do these considerations carry any weight with you?
As it happens, England and things English mean a very great deal to me. But whenever I hear somebody appealing to my sense of patriotism, I feel I'm being made to do something I don't want to do. Look, I've come here because I have decided for myself what I ought to be doing in the current circumstances. I mean, the work sounds intriguing. I think I'd be more useful here than on the battlefield.
A word of warning. Do not imagine that the nature of the work we do here will protect you from the moral responsibility for killing and destruction. Sometimes very hard decisions have to be made. How do you feel about that?
I have always been willing, indeed eager, to accept moral responsibility for what I do.
Good. Good. I've been furnished with some details of your work, Mr. Turing. Most of which, I have to tell you, I find almost totally incomprehensible.
Yeah, it's hardly surprising.
I used to be rather good at mathematics when I was younger, but
This is, well, baffling. For instance, this thing here. On computable numbers with an application to the Entscheidung problem. Can you tell me something about it?
Tell you what?
Well, anything. A few words of explanation, in general terms.
A few words of explanation?
Yes.
In general terms?
Impossible.
It's about right and wrong. In general terms. It's a technical paper in mathematical logic, but it's also about the difficulty of telling right from wrong. See, people think that, well, most people think that in mathematics, we always know what is right and what is wrong. Not so. Not anymore. It's a problem that's occupied mathematicians for 40 or 50 years. I mean, how do you tell right from wrong? Yeah, Bertrand Russell has written an immense book on the subject, his Principia Mathematica. His idea was to break down all mathematical concepts and arguments into little pieces and then show that they could be derived from pure logic. Well, he didn't quite work out that way, and after many years of intensive work, I mean, all he was able to do was to show that it's terribly difficult to do anything of the kind. But it was an important book. Important and influential. It influenced both David Hilbert and Kurt Gödel. It's rather like what physicists call splitting the atom. As analyzing the physical atom has led to the discovery of a new kind of physics, so the attempt to analyze these mathematical atoms has led to a new kind of mathematics. David Hilbert took the whole thing a stage further. I don't suppose his name means much, if anything, to you. No, well, there you are, you see. It's the way of the world. People never seem to hear about the really great mathematicians. But Hilbert looked at the problem from a completely different angle. He said if we are to have any fundamental system for mathematics, like the one Russell was trying to work out, that it must satisfy three basic requirements. Consistency, completeness, and decidability. Now, consistency means that you won't ever get a contradiction in your own system. In other words, you'll never be able to follow the rules of your system and end up showing that two and two make five. Completeness means that if any statement is true, there must be some way of proving it by using the rules of your system. And decidability means that there must exist some method, some definite procedure or test which can be applied to any given mathematical assertion and which will decide whether or not that assertion is provable. Now, Hilbert thought this a perfectly reasonable set of requirements to impose, but within a few years, Kurt Gödel showed that no system for mathematics could be both consistent and complete. And he did this by constructing a mathematical assertion which said, in effect, this assertion cannot be proved. Classic paradox. This assertion cannot be proved. Well, either it can or it can't. If it can be proved, we have a contradiction. And the system is inconsistent. If it cannot be proved, then the assertion is true. But it can't be proved, which means the system is incomplete. Thus, mathematics is either inconsistent or it's incomplete. It's a beautiful theorem. It's quite beautiful. I think Gödel's theorem is the most beautiful thing I know. But the question of decidability was still unsettled. Now, Hilbert, as I said, had thought that there should be one single, clearly defined method for deciding whether or not mathematical assertions were provable. The decision problem, he called it. The Entscheidungs problem. Now, in my book on computable numbers, I wanted to show that no one method can work for all questions. Solving mathematical problems requires an infinite supply of new ideas. Well, it was one thing to make such a claim. It was a monumental task to prove it. I needed to examine the provability of mathematical assertions, past, present, and future. I mean, how on earth were such a thing to be done? But eventually, one word gave me a clue. People have been talking about A mechanical process. A process that could be applied mechanically to solving mathematical problems without requiring any human intervention or ingenuity. Machine! That was the crucial word. I conceived the idea of a machine. A Turing machine which will be able to scan mathematical symbols. It would read them, if you like. It would read a mathematical assertion and then arrive at a verdict as to whether or not that assertion were provable. And with this concept, I was able to show that Hilbert was wrong. My idea worked.
Yes, I see. Well, I don't, but I see something, I think. The originality of your thinking is clearly remarkable. And I'm sure you'll make an invaluable member of our team. Group, call it what you will. We'd like you to start work immediately. Is that all right?
Yes, of course.
Good. Is there anything you'd like to ask me?
No, my only worry is about fitting into a place like this. I mean, I've never been very good at organising things. Least of all myself, and I'm not too sure how well I'll function in a government department.
No need to worry about that. There's a healthy disregard of organisational formality at GCCS. If there wasn't, I wouldn't be here. As far as I'm concerned, rules are only important in cricket, poetry, and scholarly editing of ancient texts. I'm going to ask Miss Green to come in. Would you ask Pat to come in, please? Patricia Green, one of our most able cryptanalysts, quite as good as any chap.
What sort of work shall I be doing?
Oh, you'll be concentrating on something called the Enigma Code. It's been devised and developed by the Germans, and it's an absolute pick. Pat? Yes, do come in. Come and meet Alan Turing.
How do you do?
Oh, how do you do?
Actually, we've met before.
Have we? When?
You read a paper to the Moral Science Club at Cambridge. We met briefly afterwards.
Oh, but that was, 6, 7 years ago.
December 1933. I remember it very clearly. I remember you saying that mathematical propositions had not just one, but a variety of interpretations. You opened up all sorts of possibilities I'd never thought of before. It was most exciting.
Thank you.
Have we found you somewhere to do?
Yes, the Crown Inn, Shenneybrook End.
Oh, good. That's only about 3 miles away. Have you got a bicycle? You'll need a bicycle. Now, I'm relying on you to tell Mr. Turing all about the Enigma Code.
Yes, of course.
What sort of code is it?
Mechanical. The message to be transmitted is encoded by this machine. The sender and receiver have the same equipment, of course. Here, on the keyboard, are three rotors. Now, the letters of the alphabet circle each rotor. If you press one of the keys, K, for example, you'll see that the plain text K is encoded into H. First rotor then moves on. Pressing K again produces the letter F, and so on and so on. When the rotor's made a complete revolution, the second does the same, and then the third. It's a polyalphabetical machine with 26 times 20 times 26 possible settings.
17,576.
Yes.
Boy, it's not a tremendously large number.
No, that's true. A manual analysis would eventually lead to the correct setting, give a little patience. But it could take several days, and the setting is changed each day.
Or how do they know which setting to use?
They use a code book, which, alas, we don't have. But at least we know how the machine works, and we've been able to modify one of our own machines to simulate the Enigma's function.
Oh.
The trouble is, the Germans have just made the Enigma much more elaborate, which means that our machine is virtually obsolete. Their operators are now equipped with a stock of 5 rotors, from which any 3 can be used in any order when they set up the Enigma.
So it's 60 possible combinations, 17,576 times 60.
1,054,560. They've also added a plug board to the apparatus, like a telephone switchboard. They just attach pairs of letters to jack plugs, And this swaps the letters before they're fed into the rotors and after. So there are literally thousands of millions of possible permutations.
Well, it's quite a problem.
The point is, this damn code is a vital part of the Nazi war effort. Vital. The army uses it, so does the Luftwaffe, and so, most importantly, do the U-boats. And if the U-boats get control of the North Atlantic, our merchant ships won't stand a chance. They'll starve us out. So, the enigma has to be broken. Somehow. Top priority.
There are no oranges and no lemons, so we made a fruit cocktail out of apples and pears.
It's a depressing colour.
Don't start finding fault. Things are difficult enough these days. Pat's coming to church with me.
Oh, good.
Do come, Alan, dear.
No, not today. Oh!
What's the matter? Mm.
It's terribly sour.
Is it?
Mm, you try it up.
Well, I already have.
I'm so glad you were able to come down today. It's so rarely Alan introduces any of his friends to us. Hardly ever, in fact. Of course, it was different when he was at school. His friend Chris used to come most holidays. Charming boy and a very nice family.
Mother, I don't think Pat wants to hear about my boyhood friendships.
Why not? It's always interesting to learn something about people you're fond of. Would you like some more?
Oh, yes. Please.
Do come to church, Alan. It'd be so nice if we all went together.
What is the point?
Well, does there have to be a point?
Well, it seems idiotic for a non-believer to spend his Sunday evening in church.
He was once extremely devout.
I was no such thing. You never understood what I thought. This needs sugar. Don't we have any sugar?
Well, we only get 8 ounces a week, or doesn't rationing apply to people like you?
Oh, so people like me?
One's always hearing about people in hush-hush jobs living off the fat of the land.
Would you say we lived off the fat of the land?
Hardly.
Hardly? Absolutely not. And stop fishing.
Fishing?
Yes, all these little hints about hush-hush jobs. You know perfectly well we can't tell you what we do.
Don't be cross. I'll go and see if we've got any sugar.
She's quite right, you know.
Hmm? What about?
Well, I do like hearing about... I do like hearing about your family and friends. I wish you talked about them.
Oh, I do, sometimes.
Who's Chris?
Christopher Morecambe. We were at school together.
Your mother obviously liked him.
One was a very remarkable boy. Oh, he was very clever, very perceptive, very mature for his age. He made everybody else seem so ordinary. It was one of those intense friendships that only happen when you're young. I worship the ground he walked on.
Have you kept in touch?
He died.
Oh.
No, he'd had TB when he was a small boy. And he hadn't really recovered, and I didn't know. I mean, he never told me. He was taken ill at school. We were all asleep. Next morning I heard he'd been rushed to hospital, and he died. 6 days later.
Thursday, February the 13th, 1930.
I was devastated. I felt I should have died, not him. The only possible excuse for living was that I should achieve something that Christopher could no longer do. I used to think, you know, after he died, I almost believed he was still with me. In spirit, and could help me. I suppose, gave my mother the impression I was devoutly religious. I wasn't that at all. I was just obsessed with this idea, this question, whether or not Christopher's mind could exist without his body. I mean, it was an obsession that stayed with me for years. What are mental processes? Can they take place in something other than a living brain? You see, in a way, in a very real way,
Many of the problems I've tried to solve in my work lead directly back to Christopher. Wouldn't he be amused?
I think he'd be pleased.
Hope so.
Look at that. It's a fur coat.
I can see it's a fur coat.
Well, take it. Well, look at it.
I am going to tell you something extraordinary about this fur coat.
It looks ordinary enough to me.
Define what is meant by a Fibonacci sequence.
A Fibonacci sequence is a sequence of numbers where each is the sum of the previous two. So you start with one, then one plus one equals two. One and two, three, two and three, five.
Three and five, eight, five and eight, 13. Good! Well done, full marks.
Look at this fur coat. Look at the pattern of the bracts, the leaves. Follow them, spiraling round the cone, 8 lines twisting to the left, 13 lines twisting to the right. The numbers always come from a Fibonacci sequence.
Always?
Always. And it's not just fur cones. The petals of most flowers grow in the same way. Isn't that amazing?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. And it prompts the age-old question. Is God a mathematician?
I love you, Prof. I love you. You know that?
Yes.
You're supposed to say, I love you too.
Yes, I know.
Please say something.
Well, I don't think of myself as a very lovable person.
Well, you are.
Lots of men at Bletchley far more lovable than I am.
That's why you're wrong.
Don't be silly. Of course there are. I see them every lunchtime. All rushing around, laughing, playing round. I'm amazed you haven't fallen in love with one of them.
Because they're dull, that's why.
So am I.
Oh, that's where you're wrong. You're untidy and messy and lacking almost all the social graces. I mean, your clothes are stained and you bite your nails. You tell the truth when it would be kinder to tell a lie. And you've got no patience with people who bore you, but you are not dull. And I love you.
As a matter of fact, I do love you.
As a friend.
As a friend.
That might change. Perhaps it might change.
No. I'm a homosexual.
I know. That doesn't stop me loving you. It needn't stop you loving me.
It would stop me making love to you. I don't want that sort of life. And I don't think you do either.
I've got an extremely closely guarded secret in this room. Real scotch. Like some?
No, not for me, thank you. I don't like it.
You don't? What a shame. I thought a modest celebration might be appropriate. Pat tells me you've managed to decode some German U-boat messages.
Yes, for a time we thought we'd done it, but now it seems the Germans have improved the Enigma machine, so we're going to have to find a new way in. Well, we'll do it, Knox, but we need faster machinery.
Well, at least the government is probably aware of how important your work is. The geese who lay the golden eggs, isn't that what Churchill said?
Oh, he meant all of us.
You in particular.
This is very flattering, Knox. You're making me feel uneasy.
Why's that?
Well, I sense a sting in the tail approaching.
Well, not a sting, exactly. I gather you've been chaining your tea mug to the radiator.
That's not an unreasonable precaution. Tea mugs are in very short supply.
Some people find it irritating.
Well, I find it irritating that some people should be irritated.
I do think you might be a little more discreet.
What about my tea mug?
About this young engineer chap you've got working with you. Tongues are beginning to wag.
Am I in for a lesson in morals?
In common sense. I mean, I don't give a tuppenny damn whether you choose to go to bed with choir boys or cocker spaniels, but it would be wiser to keep your private life to yourself.
Is this an official reprimand?
Friendly advice, nothing more. I mean, first things first. What we are doing here, and most especially what you're doing here, has a direct and crucial bearing on the progress of the war. A pretty young engineer comes a rather poor second to that, surely.
I thought you said rules only mattered in cricket.
Oh, it's such nonsense, this contemporary obsession with sexual fulfillment. Passion is dreadfully overrated, if you ask me. One is happiest when sex is a dimly remembered pleasure, like climbing apple trees or building sandcastles.
Well, you can hardly expect me to agree with that.
Well, like all of us, I can only speak from personal experience. I've been happily married for over 20 years, and I'm glad to say that passion has never played a significant role in our relationship. Understanding and companionship can be relied upon. Passion is forever fleeting.
Well, perhaps one brief moment of passion is worth more than 20 years of uneventful companionship.
Oh, I didn't say it was uneventful. Anyway, we're not talking about me, we're talking about you.
Yes, I hear you're not very well.
What's that got to do with it?
Nothing, I'm changing the subject.
A great many people, administrators and the military alike, regard Bletchley as a hotbed of anarchy and unruliness. They pray for an excuse to bring us to heel.
Well, they're small-minded, petty, spiteful.
Maybe.
What is the point of having a system that gives authority to people who don't deserve it? You say I complained. Good God, of course I complained. Nothing was being done. You know that as well as I do. Nobody understood the scale of the problem. I mean, it wasn't just a question of more staff, more money. We needed new ideas, electronics, an industry. Absolutely, bugger all was being done about it. If I hadn't written to Mr. Churchill, if I had gone through the usual so-called proper channels, we'd all be stuck here twiddling our thumbs, getting nowhere fast. Do these people know how Churchill replied to my letter? Do they? Make sure they have all they want on extreme priority.
I know.
That is what he wrote.
I know.
Action this day.
I know. And I know you did the wrong thing. I'm only trying to explain why such unorthodox methods are bound to cause a considerable upset.
All that matters is the work we do. Differences of attitude, differences of personality should not enter into it.
They shouldn't, but they do.
Well, then they should be ignored.
You can't go through life ignoring the effect you have on other people or the effect other people have on you.
Well, you can try.
All right. Let me give you an example. A few minutes ago, you inquired after my health. Supposing I'd said that I'm mortally ill and that I've only a year or so to live. Supposing I'd broken down, wept. Supposing I'd opened my heart to you and said that I have no wish to die, that I am frightened and in despair. Well, I can't believe you would have welcomed such a disclosure. I feel sure you would have found it distressing, embarrassing, somewhat inconsiderate. And so, having regard for your feelings as well as my own, it would seem to be both correct and appropriate for me to moderate my response.
Are you dying?
Similarly, well, so it seems to me. When you reveal the nature of your sexuality, you cannot afford to ignore
the effect you're having on other people. Fear, for example, when people are asked to accept something they do not understand. Or anger, when what you so unashamedly reveal is contrary to everything they've ever believed in. And pain. Bound to cause a lot of pain. Not yourself, necessarily, that's your affair anyway, but to people who are close to you. Anyone who's fond of you. Pain, real pain.
Well, I think perhaps I will have a drink after all. You sure I can't persuade you?
No, thank you.
Your friend Wittgenstein once wrote something that impressed me deeply. I sat down and there with a book in my hand and memorized what he'd written. This is what he said. We feel that even when all possible scientific questions have been answered, the problems of life remain completely unanswered.
Sorry to bother you at home, sir.
Oh, it's no bother. Come in.
Thank you.
I've just been to do a bit of running.
Oh.
Not as much as I used to, lass.
Thank you.
Middle age creeping on.
What were you, long distance, sprinting or what?
Long distance. Marathon, actually.
Oh, God, I couldn't run that far when I was 20, let alone now.
Do sit down. Do you want to ask me some more questions?
Yes, sir, I do. But first of all, I think we should try to clear up this story of yours.
What story?
The one about a young man coming to your house to sell things. Brushes, I think you said.
Yes.
We have good reason to believe that you were lying. Were you lying?
Yes.
Why?
I'm sorry, it was very foolish of me.
Would you like to tell me what really happened?
Well, there was no brush salesman. A friend told me about the burglar. George? Yes.
How did this friend know about the burglary?
Well, he didn't know exactly. He guessed.
How did he guess?
Well, he'd been having a drink with George in a milk bar, and he mentioned me. My friend mentioned me. Told George where I lived. He'd been to dinner, you see. My friend had been to dinner a few days before. He was telling George all about it, and then when the burglary happened, I mentioned it to my friend, and then he said, well, it might have been George, because he knew that George was a petty thief, whatever the expression is. He just guessed.
Well, your friend was right.
Was he?
Detectives found some fingerprints here in your house. This man, George, has a criminal record.
Oh, I see. Ah, yeah, and that proves it. Yeah. Yes, I see.
This friend of yours, what's his name?
Ron. Ron Miller.
A colleague of yours at the university?
Well, no.
Social acquaintance?
Yes, sort of.
Have you known him long?
Not long.
How long?
Well, 3 or 4 weeks.
How did you meet?
Well, you know, just casually.
So he's just a casual social acquaintance?
Yes.
Not what you call a close friend?
No.
So why did you lie to conceal his identity?
Well, I didn't want to get him into trouble.
Why not?
Oh,
he was, after all, partly responsible for your house being burgled.
No, I wouldn't say that.
Wouldn't you say? Well,
no, I wouldn't say responsible.
Partly responsible.
Well, it's difficult to say, isn't it? I mean, it's difficult to say just exactly what his involvement in all this actually was. He's...
He told George your address.
Yes.
And presumably knows that George has got a criminal record.
Yes.
So why go to all these lengths to protect him?
Well, the truth is, I'm having an affair with him.
With Miller?
With Ron. Yes.
You're having a sexual relationship with this man?
Yes.
What sort of sexual relationship?
How many sorts are there?
You tell me, sir.
Well, what exactly do you want to know?
I need to understand the precise nature of this sexual relationship.
You mean... Well, you want to know what we did?
That would help.
Oh. Well, since you ask, it wasn't much more than mutual masturbation.
Did penetration occur?
No.
You do realise, don't you, sir, that this is a criminal offence?
Isn't all this rather beside the point? I thought we were trying to establish you would burgle my house.
That's part of it, yes.
Well, it's part of it. It's part of what?
You've just told me that you've committed a criminal offence. I can't ignore that, can I?
What criminal offence?
Gross indecency.
Oh, no, look, I didn't corrupt Ron. He knew exactly what he was doing. I mean, he came to my house... My house, don't forget, perfectly well aware that we would almost certainly end up in bed together. It didn't come as any great surprise to him. He's had other homosexual experiences. It's ludicrous talking about criminal offences. And everything happened here. In private. In my own house. In private. If I hadn't told you, you wouldn't have known anything about it.
Well, you did tell me.
Well, can't you forget about it? Can't you?
How old is this man, Miller?
He's 19, 20.
And how old are you, sir?
Obviously, I shouldn't have told you. I mean, I'm all saying things I shouldn't say, but surely there's no need to make a fuss about this. Surely you can forget what I told you. Can't you? Look, I'm not asking much. Please? Well, what is the position if I make a statement? Shall I?
That's up to you, sir.
Anyway, all right, I'll make a statement. You want me down to the police station? Better get dressed.
Who is it?
It's me.
My dear, you are so silly. Why didn't you tell me you were coming down?
Well, I wasn't sure I'd be able to make it. I didn't want to disappoint you.
Well, it's a wonderful surprise. I'm delighted. Mm. Just look at that dreadful old jacket. I do wish you'd take more care of yourself. Now, how long can you stay? Don't tell me you've got to go rushing off tomorrow morning.
Well, yes, I may have to.
Well, never mind. We won't think about that. I've had the spare room completely redecorated. Lovely curtains, Liberty print.
Mother... Listen, I've got something to tell you.
Something nice?
No, I'm afraid not.
No, you wouldn't have come all this way to tell me anything nice. What is it?
Well, I'm in trouble.
What sort of trouble?
Serious trouble.
Tell me.
Well, it's so difficult to explain.
Is it something to do with money?
Well, no. Look, you know I've never been very interested in women.
People of your sort seldom are.
My sort? What do you mean, my sort?
People who spend their lives with their heads buried in books.
It has nothing to do with that.
What then?
I have no sexual feelings for women.
That's probably just as well. People seem to be getting divorced at such a rate these days.
Mother, will you please listen? Will you please try to understand?
I'm doing my best.
The police have discovered that I'm having an affair with a man.
A man?
Yes. I'm sorry. There is no other way to tell you.
You mean a Nancy boy? Will it be in the papers?
I don't know. Perhaps.
Thank God your father isn't alive. He was so proud of you. Have you always, have you always been like this?
Yes.
Always?
Yes.
But what about that girl you were engaged to? What was her name? Pat?
Mother, I was never engaged to her.
I thought you loved her.
I was fond of her. Yes, I loved her as a friend.
What's going to happen?
There'll be a trial.
Sending you to court?
Yes.
Well, will you go to prison?
Possibly.
How did the police find out? Did they catch you? Did they find you with this man?
I told them.
Why? Why?
Sorry.
Oh, Alan. How could you bear to touch a man like that? How could you do such a thing? Will it affect your career?
I suppose so.
How?
I don't know.
What can I do to help?
Well, nothing.
Well, there must be something I can do. Let me, please. You look so helpless.
Yes, that's how I feel.
Do you remember when you were at Hazelhurst? You must have been about 10 or 11. We'd all been to Scotland for the summer holidays. Do you remember?
Loch Inver.
Daddy went trout fishing. I sketched. We went for picnic teas in the heather. And then we had to go back to India. You had to go back to school. Back to Hazelhurst.
Yes.
Do you remember?
Yes, of course I remember.
We took a taxi to the school. And as we drove away, you tried to run after us. You ran along the drive after the taxi. Your arms were flung wide. Your mouth was open. You were saying something, shouting something, but I couldn't hear what it was. There were some shrubs by the school gates. Rhododendrons, I think. It was like a great green curtain being pulled across in front of my eyes. The shrubs hit you from my side. I couldn't see you anymore. For a moment, I felt quite breathless with panic. I wanted to jump out of the taxi and run back and hold you in my arms forever.
I had no idea you felt like that.
About 9 p.m, Mr. Turing went out of the room to make a phone call. He left his jacket on the arm of a chair, and I knocked off £8 out of it. After a while, he came back to the kitchen again. He leaned over me, put his head on my shoulder, and pulled my hand between his legs. I wanked him again, but he never touched me. I didn't do this for my own benefit sexually, but I heard that you could get paid for it. I'll never do it again if I'm given a chance. I know that it's wrong.
Okay, Miller. Sign here.
Just tea and cakes.
Thank you. It's good to see you, Prof.
It's good to see you too.
Thank you for writing to me.
Well, I wanted you to know what had happened, and I wanted you to hear it from me and not, you know, second hand.
Thank you.
Oh, it was in the Sunday papers. One headline said, accused had powerful brain. So it could have been worse, I suppose. But their use of the past tense rather worried me.
I've thought about you a lot. It must have been awful.
No, actually, no. It wasn't as bad as I'd feared. They put me in cells during the trial, and being behind bars was by no means disagreeable. It was a wonderful absence of responsibility. It's rather like being back at school.
Did you think that they were going to put you into prison?
No, not really. No, I was a first offender, after all. There's a laugh. First offender. No, I thought they most probably put me on probation. They're giving me drugs.
Who are?
They're giving me estrogen. Female sex hormones. It's supposed to kill male sexual interest, but it's only for a year. After that, everything returns to normal. We hope.
That's dreadful. Couldn't you refuse?
No. I'm obliged to do it. No, they put me on probation, provided that I agreed to the drug treatment. I'm growing breasts.
Oh, Helen.
And nobody seems to know whether or not they'll disappear when I stop taking the drugs. Well, just have to wait and see.
God, how dreadful.
The embarrassment factor is high. Keep wondering if I'll have to wear a bra.
How did your mother take it?
Yes, I dreaded telling her. Absolutely dreaded it. As it happens, she was wonderful. Remarkable. It seems to have drawn us closer together.
I'm glad.
Yes, so am I.
What happened to the boy?
The boy? Oh, he was conditionally discharged. He works in London, I think. I don't know. I never see him.
Oh, here you are, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, you're married?
Yes.
No job?
Just a housewife.
Are you happy?
Yes. Well, I suppose so. Don't really think about it very much.
Well, that means you are.
I do hope you're not too unhappy.
I'm not unhappy at all. I have some very good friends. I had a very jolly holiday. Norway.
Norway?
No legal problems in Norway. I was told that there were places there where they held dances for men only. It's not true, unfortunately. But I did meet the most charming young man called Kel. As a matter of fact, he wrote to me last week. Wants to come and stay. Few days, chez moi. Obviously, I made a good impression.
What sort of work are you doing?
I'm at Manchester University.
Yes, I know that.
We've built a digital computer. Do you remember all my theorizing about universal machines? Well, we have done it. We've made one. It's all thanks to our work at Bletchley.
How exciting. That means so exciting.
And I'm using the computer to simulate the growth patterns of plants and animals. Like the Fibonacci patterns in a fur cone. Do you remember me telling you about that?
Yes.
On summer's afternoon, and you thought you were in love with me.
I went to church with your mother. I cried all through the sermon.
You have not changed one bit, do you know that?
It's kind of you to say so.
No, it's true. Oh, it seems a long time since Bletchley.
Doesn't it?
Oh, a lifetime.
I wonder if your tea mug is still chained to the radiator.
No, I was told off about that.
Who by?
Dilly Knox.
Oh, poor Mr. Knox. I went to see him when he was ill, near the end.
Oh, that was good of you.
Well, I was fond of him. He was so ill, they were saying prayers for him in the church. Mr. Knox was furious about it. Christianity is a 2,000-year-old swindle, he said. It makes you fear where there is nothing to fear, and hope when there's nothing to hope for.
Oh, good. No, he was a remarkable man.
I suppose you knew he was a homosexual.
What?
Well, homosexually inclined, anyway. He was supposed to have had some sort of romance with Maynard Keynes.
Knox?
When he was young.
Are you sure?
Well, an uncle of mine was at school with him.
Good God.
Lytton Strachey, too, although that was at Cambridge, not Eton.
He was Lytton Strachey's lover?
Apparently. I thought you knew.
I had the faintest idea. I mean, he never even dropped a hint.
Well, I don't think anybody paid much attention to it. Everything's so very different when you're at school or university.
Good God almighty.
I mean, it was a thing of the past. He was devoted to his wife.
Oh, yes, he told me. Well, that's what you do, isn't it? You have your fling when you're young, then you conform later. I should have married you. Yeah, well, this would never have happened. I should have played the game and stuck to the rules.
Why didn't you?
I couldn't.
Mr. Turing, sorry to keep you waiting. Everything's at sixes and sevens here today. My secretary's gone down with flu, and the temporary girl doesn't seem to know what she's doing. Do sit down.
Thank you.
It's good of you to come along at such short notice. Thank you very much.
Well, your letter was rather vague.
It was?
Yeah, well, official, but rather vague.
Well, it's just one of those things that's done better by meeting than by telephone. Basically, it's simply a question of keeping in touch.
How do you mean?
You're a brilliant man, Mr. Turing. Unique in many ways. There's no point in trying to deny it.
No, I wasn't going to.
This country has always tended to take its brilliant men for granted. That's a mistake, a serious mistake. We can't afford to make mistakes like that.
Who are you? I have no idea who you are.
I'm sorry. My name is Smith. John Smith. Nobody believes it. I have a dreadful time with hotel clerks. Anyway, the point is this. It would be foolish to pretend that your homosexuality hasn't created problems and certain anxieties.
For whom?
But providing we can discuss the situation reasonably, I feel sure that these anxieties can be reduced to a minimum.
What anxieties?
Say, it's simply a question of keeping in touch.
You're talking about security problems.
I am. Thanks to Mrs. Burgess and McLean, the Americans are getting increasingly jumpy. They have, after all, given you access to some extremely sensitive information. There's a general feeling of unease.
About me?
Of course, we know that you're a man of the greatest integrity. Your essential loyalty has never been questioned. But all things have to be considered.
Such as?
Can you say in all honesty that you would never, never under any circumstances, reveal something of the nature of your work to one of your lovers?
No, of course not.
No, you would, or no, you wouldn't?
No, I cannot say, in all honesty, that such a circumstance would never arise. Neither can you. Who could?
That being the case, one's attention is drawn to your choice of lover. You seem to have an unusually wide range of acquaintances.
Oh, you mean it would be all right if I went to bed with other mathematicians? Preferably from one of the older universities. Preferably with what the Americans call security clearance.
Yes, I'm sure that would make us a lot happier. Sorry, that was rather glib. But you must realize that your work for the intelligence service means that you're simply not free to behave as you might choose. You have had extremely unusual access to secret information. That carries with it a heavy, if not irksome, responsibility.
I am aware of that.
Yes, I'm sure you are. It may seem like interference. In fact, we're trying to be helpful.
How?
By preventing any further error of judgment.
Meaning what, exactly?
This young Norwegian, Kell, I think it would be unwise of him to visit you here.
How do you know about Kell?
Somebody told me.
Who?
I forget. Truly.
Am I being watched?
We can't afford to take any chances, Mr. Turing. I'm sure you appreciate that.
Well, if I'm that much of a danger, you should get somebody to push me under a bus.
Yes, you must forgive me. I do tend to exaggerate the problem. It is, as I say, simply a question of keeping in touch.
Precisely what does that mean?
We'd like to be told of any change of residence, any change in your working life, any trips abroad, that sort of thing. Are you planning to go abroad this year?
Yes, I'm going to Greece.
When?
May.
Whereabouts in Greece?
Corfu.
That's very nice there. You'll like it a lot. May is the perfect time to go.
I want you to know that I have no regrets about my involvement with the intelligence service. The work I did at Bletchley was very important to me.
Yes, I'm sure it was.
Yes, important! In a way you probably cannot understand. Look, let me try and explain something. In order to unravel the messages encoded by the Enigma machine, we had to make certain deductions. We had to deduce the position of the machine's rotors for each transmission. Now, in other words, we had to construct a chain of logical deductions for each of the rotor positions. Now, if this chain of deductions led you to a contradiction, that meant you were wrong. And you had to move on to the next rotor position and start all over again, and so on, and so on. And it was an impossibly lengthy and laborious task, and we didn't know what to do. And then suddenly one spring afternoon, just after lunch, I remembered a conversation that I'd had with Wittgenstein. We were discussing an elementary theorem in mathematical logic which states that a contradiction implies any proposition. And I saw immediately if we build a machine that embodied this idea, we would have a code-breaking machine with the necessary speed. Now, it would have to be a machine of electrical relays and logical circuits which could sense contradictions, recognize consistencies. Now, if your guess was wrong, electricity would flow through all the related hypotheses and knock them out in a flash. If your guess was right, everything would be consistent. And the electrical current would stop at the correct combination. Our machine would be able to examine thousands of millions of permutations at amazing speed. With any luck, it would give us the way in. What a moment that was. It was extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. I remember it was a beautiful sunny day.
The lawn had just been cut. Everywhere the smell of mown grass. I could hear the shouts and the laughter of the men playing round us. I felt a marvellous sense of triumph and exhilaration.
But it didn't take me long to realise that it's not breaking the code that matters. It's where you go from there. That's the real problem. So you see, it took more than mathematics and electronic ingenuity to crack the U-boat enigma. It required determination, tenacity, moral fibre, if you like. That's what made it all so deeply satisfying. Everything came together there, all the strands of my life. My work as a mathematician, my interest in ciphers, my ability to solve practical problems. My love of my country! You trusted me then. Why not now?
These are your son's personal belongings. As you know, a few odds and ends had to be examined before the coroner could complete his report. You better make sure everything's there.
Do I have to?
Not if it upsets you.
I think I'd rather not.
I kept this separately. It's his medal. His OBE. I was afraid it might get lost.
Thank you.
So if you'd just sign this, please. Just there. That's good. Thank you. I didn't know he'd got the OBE. He never told me.
What was it for?
The work he did during the war, whatever that was. There are so many things I know nothing about. So many things I don't understand.
Yes, it's a sad business. I'm very sorry.
Of course, it was all a dreadful mistake.
In what way?
The coroner's verdict. To say that Alan took his own life is quite ridiculous. Everybody knew he did experiments at home, and he never washed his hands, never. It was obviously a tragic accident.
I couldn't really offer an opinion, Mrs. Jury.
You met him. Do you think he was the sort of man to commit suicide?
It's 2 or 3 years since I've seen him. You never know what people might do in extreme circumstances.
Let me tell you something about my son. His first day at Sherborne was also the first day of the general strike. He bicycled all the way from Southampton to Sherborne, 60 miles, so he would be sure of getting to school on time. It was reported in the local newspaper. A boy who could do that would never take his own life. And he was still young. He had everything to live for, everything.
Alan Turing was awarded the OBE in 1946. He died in 1954. In 1993, part of a ring road in Manchester was named the Alan Turing Way in his honour. The leader of Manchester City Council said, "Alan Turing has never received the recognition to which he is entitled. We now have a chance to put that right."